And now we need our axial depth cuts at the height of contour on the buccal and the lingual. And once we're done with that, now we're ready to fly. So the steps on a posterior tooth, as you can see here, we're gonna break the contacts on the mesial and the distal with our 56 carbide burr. We're gonna place a double zero retraction cord in here. Again, this is a plain cord, hasn't been soaked in anything. We're gonna cut the two ends flush so that we don't have any overlap. And then we're gonna do our margination. So we're gonna take our 801, we'll just call this, let's say an 016 if we're doing like a zirconia crown. And we're gonna trace it from the mesial facial line angle to the distal facial line angle. And then the same on the lingual side, from the mesial lingual to the distal lingual. Sometimes with the smaller round burrs, the 014 and the 016, it'll actually fit in between the teeth, like right over where you just made your 56 burr. So if it'll fit there, if you have room between the tooth you're prepping and the adjacent tooth, feel free to kind of go all the way through there with that round burr. And again, anytime you hold that round burr parallel to the long axis of the tooth, the shank of the burr acts as kind of a self-limiting depth cutter. On anterior teeth, as you might have noticed, the head of the handpiece has to be held away a little bit, so it angles the burr a little bit more, which is good. It gets it into kind of its full depth. And so you make your margin preparation on the buccal and the lingual with your round burr, then place your depth cuts in the central groove and the lingual cusps. And for the first couple times you do it, just do the two buccal cusps too, just to say that you did. So you're gonna end up with all your depth cuts on the occlusal. And now we need our axial depth cuts at the height of contour on the buccal and the lingual. And once we're done with that, now we're ready to fly. So we take a little extra time up front, but essentially, again, I refer to this as kind of like having GPS or a surgical guide for this preparation, because you know when you're done. So then I'm gonna grab that 856025 burr and literally just kind of hold it parallel to the occlusal surface while simultaneously pushing the tip down to get to the bottom of that depth cut in the central groove and on the cusp tip. You could also use that football burr, the 379023, if you wanted to here. It really doesn't matter what you use to do this gross reduction. Whatever floats your boat would be fine. And then I'm gonna use the 856025 or maybe the 021 based, again, if we're doing solid zirconia, to prep an axial wall. There's taper built into that burr, so really kind of try to hold that burr straight up and down. It's way more difficult to undercut a single tooth than you think it is. I mean, provided there's not a big hole in the back of it from an amalgam that comes out of it. So we're gonna go around and prep with our tapered burr, our 856 burr. And when you do this, you're gonna end up with two sharp angles, one on the buccal and one on the lingual on the occlusal surface, as you see here. And don't use a burr to smooth those off. It's much better to use a sandpaper disc like you see here. Actually, I asked the animator for a sandpaper disc and I got what looks to be a Joe Dandy. So I know that looks like a very violent way to smooth off a 90 degree angle on a tooth. And we're gonna smooth off those angles. We used to do it because the all ceramics we had were too weak to have a 90 degree angle, a point, a sharp point on the prep. That's not true today with lithium disilicate with zirconia. What is true is those are both milled restorations, and all of our milling units, the burrs that are in the milling units have rounded tips. So a milling unit cannot mill to a 90 degree angle like that. So what it does instead is it over mills. So it mills past it with that round tip, this kind of zone of safety around it, so that it knows the crown will fit on the prep if you leave that sharp edge, which is fine. That's a great strategy for the software to have. But if we're already at minimum thickness right on that spot on the occlusal surface, and then it over mills in that area, it could violate that minimum material thickness. So a Bruxer crown that was supposed to be 0.6 mm could now be 0.4 mm because of the milling strategy, where it's gonna mill beyond that to ensure that it seats. The point being, round off any sharp edges of any milled restorations, not because of the strength of the material, but because the mill uses rounded end burrs and needs of that, because it can't prep 90 degree angles on the inside of a crown. The next step, once we smooth off those angles, is put the top cord in. I put a 2E cord in. The size 2 cord is a top cord, fits on maxillary anterior teeth. It fits on lower molars very well. It won't fit, it sometimes will fit on lower bicuspids, but it will not fit on lower anterior. So for lower anteriors, for example, I put a double zero cord first, and my top cord's probably gonna be a zero. On lower bicuspids, it's usually a double zero with a 1 cord on top, and then on the molars, double zero cord with a 2 on top. And then upper bicuspids, because of the lack of attached gingiva there, it's usually a double zero cord that'll fit everywhere. And then a zero chord or a one just based on how thin and friable that tissue looks to be. We don't want to do any damage with this. So yeah, I'd always love to have a ton of lateral retraction of the tissue away from the tooth. But one of our goals in this is not to create any damage to the patient's biology, to the connective tissue. So if I can only settle for, you know, a one chord instead of a two chord, that's fine. As long as we have any lateral separation, we're still gonna make the technicians very happy and they're gonna be able to clearly see what we're doing. If the patient's sensitive to epi and a local anesthetic injection, then don't use it in the cord, just use a plain two chord instead of a two E chord. Then we're gonna place our anatomical Comprecap on top, and the patient's gonna bite down, and on posterior teeth, they can really crank on this. So if you're doing a crown with some really bad looking gingiva, and it's frankly, you shouldn't be taking the impression of the day, but you are, because you wanna put it into production. Sometimes the tissue's just too edematous and boggy to even hold cord. Those are the cases where I go in with the diode laser and take the tissue away. And then we'll use something like Traxinet or Expacil to help with the bleeding. And then we put the Comprecap on top, have the patient bite down for 10 minutes. I come, and why 10 minutes? Because that's how long it takes me to do a hygiene exam. But no, 10 minutes in this case is to get all the blood out of there. Take it off, rinse off whatever styptic material you're using. It will look like the patient had a gingival transplant. I mean, the gingiva looks so good, it will blow you away. Don't admire it too long because the blood's coming back from the capillary bed and it's angry that it's been forced out for the last 5 minutes. So take it off and quickly take that impression. But these anatomical Comprecaps can be lifesavers in dubious crown and bridge situations, especially on posterior teeth, anteriors too, but especially on posterior teeth. So I hope that through this prep sequence, I've been able to share a couple things with you and my passion on behalf of technicians worldwide for why we need to step our game up and actually prep to the requirements for the materials we're choosing. Again, it's hard for us to like die on the altar of conservatism when we're not picking conservative materials and then under prepping them and saying, I'm conservative. Pick more conservative materials, but still prep enough to get there. So if I'm prepping a crown for the first time, I'm using reverse prep all day long because it's my way for getting to a great prep. I'm more challenged when I take off an old crown another dentist has done, and now I have to start shaping that prep. But my guiding principle is again the same thing. I wanna make sure I have enough reduction in the right areas, and that's gonna help give me a good looking crown.